And I was asking her about end of course exams, and I said, asked her if they had a final and an end of course, and she said yes. And I said, does that end of course affect your grade? She said, haha, no, I guessed on the whole thing. So they don't care. It's not very hard to get to the next grade level, so if you base a teacher off of that, then you won't have a job. But that's my answer to it.
What do you think about evaluating schools at sort of an aggregate level based on achievement tests? Or what would you, what would you suggest for evaluating schools?
So that, so No Child Left Behind kind of plays into that. It used to be very dangerous when the bottom schools with the low funding would stay on bottom, and the top schools that get all the money from their scores stay on top. That's a vicious cycle. That has changed though. So now the way it's done in Kentucky, I believe, is that funding is based on a per student basis. So that helps kind of even out funding you receive to combat that top and bottom split. So it plays into it because schools still do have to meet standards, and if they don't, they could face penalties of not getting funding, but they've evened it out. So it still plays a role.
So do you think that's okay or good, or what else would you suggest as a way to evaluate schools?
I'd probably combine achievement scores and GPAs, honestly, because then you're getting more data about the school and the students, and it's not just one thing. It's a combination. It's never good to just have. Don't have all your eggs in one basket. Don't invest all your money into one stock. Put it into fund. Look at the whole picture. Don't put a microscope on the school.
There's always going to be those students who don't care, who don't do their homework, don't perform on tests. But I mean, if they start to see an average GPA, average testing scores, if all those start to drop, a majority of students, I think that's different. But just because some students aren't performing well in classrooms, I don't think that should, the whole school should be penalized for that.
Well, assuming that schools could publish sort of an average GPA, I think it gets back to Mr. Cheever's question earlier, what would you think about a school that consistently performs below the state average on standardized tests, yet your average GPA is a 3.95? What might you think about that school?
Wait, is average low
if you're going to publish both an average GPA for the school and have publish their test scores, you have a school that for the past 5 years has consistently performed below the state average. So, for example, if we were using ACT scores, like, I don't know what the state ACT average is here in Kentucky, like 20. But so you're consistently, your students are getting 18s. And I don't really mean this for the ACT, I'm talking about other standardized testing. But you publish your average grade point average for my students, my average student gets a 3.9. What might that indicate about the school?
So what I would take from that is, I would assume the school wouldn't be teaching how it should be, because it's kind of odd. Because I know here, like, students that have 4.0 are probably going to be good in their ACT, most of the time. But that, to me, I don't, the research we didn't really look into that as much, but that kind of ties into where Vanderbilt was the example we were given by Ms. Allen on how schools, as I was talking about earlier, put the number on how high schools perform. So, like, the schools that perform lower, they would get a lower score if they take into account.
I think grade inflation would be a part of that. We have people that add that.
Is that like, I'm sorry, what's
my question? Teachers bumping up people's scores to make them look better.
You have to take that into account for sure. You can't ignore it. That's why I think the average of the two is the best. But it's a factor for sure. I don't disagree at all.
you guys talked a lot about the ACT and the SAT and, you know, tests that they take at the end of the year in elementary schools. What's your opinion on, Mrs. Eiler mentioned it a few minutes ago, graduate school tests, the GRE, the LSAT, the MCAT. How do you feel about those?
As actually, my brother, he is a senior at UK right now, and then after he takes a short break from school, he will be going to graduate school. And he did mention, he asked that he explained it as the equivalent of the ACT for high college graduates. By the time you've completed a level of higher education and he's 24 years old, he can handle that stress. He can prepare. He's a grown adult, mature enough to take his life in his own hands, say, am I going to study? Am I not? Am I going to be prepared? So I don't have a problem with that at all. They're adults. It's their life. They better prepare how they see fit for a test like that.
I know you just have about a minute left. Was there anything else that you found in your research that you wanted to share that we didn't ask you about? Or anything that you found interesting?
I would say one of the biggest things that really stood out to us was how when schools take into account like a personal level, like it means not only a lot to the school and the student as well, because it shows like the school cares. We thought that'd be cool, but we'd like to see more colleges offer that. And as you said earlier, it would be more expensive, but it would be, I guess, we could assume more, not advantage, but they could see more.
I thought it was shocking, the business aspect of it. You know, they call themselves a nonprofit, but then you take people and you realize how much money they're worth.
Yeah, if I noticed anything that I thought was interesting, I never realized how much harder the ACT may be for underprivileged areas, because I almost take for granted, oh, I'm going to go see Mr. Forty again today and practice. I didn't realize how much of an advantage school might have on this test. Now,